Welcome to this discussion on taxation and land economics. What we're going to be looking at in this presentation is the matter of public funding and land. First of all, a little economic theory. It is well known by economists that all taxation is ultimately taken out of land value. And so what we're going to be looking at here is the way that taxation relates to land values, and especially how that impacts on the question of land tax. That we'll be seeing is probably one of the most misunderstood aspects of property and economics in our community today. First of all, we can note that taxation is ultimately taken from land value, not property value. And so we're going to be talking a lot about land values and land rents. We're not going to be talking so much about property values, because the property value includes the improvements that we are going to see perform very different to the land underlying the entire property. To understand the relationship between taxation and land value, one of the first things we're going to have to look closely at is the fact that land value is always a residual. So far, we've noticed the residual nature of land values in our exploration of development economics and the residual land value approach for development land valuation. And really, lurking within the developer's equation that we use for residual land value is this simple fact that land is always valued as a residual. However, we need to look at that a little bit further and look at the way that it actually pervades all aspects of land value, not merely development land value. When we look at the question of land value taxation, or land tax, we find that there's actually a number of different forms of taxation or other community charges that boil down to ultimately the same thing, some sort of a state levy on land value. Actually, the levy, or the land tax, is always more correctly understood as a participation or a share or a levy placed on land rents. And so the importance of understanding the extent of land rents is absolutely fundamental to understanding this topic. The different practical applications of land taxes can be seen, first of all, in Australia in the various state land taxes. And because land taxes require an understanding of land values, each one of the Australian states maintains a state valuation office of some sort, known by different names, including Valuer General's Department or State Valuations Department or other names. But the state land taxes are only one form of land tax. Another, which is even more common, are local government rates. Local government rates are often, but not always, levied on the unimproved value, which is really another name for land value. A third practical instance of land value taxation is where private owners don't hold freehold titles to land from the Crown. They only hold leasehold titles. And we find that over 40% of the privately owned or privately occupied land of Australia is owned by some form of state leasehold. We find that in various rural parts of Australia, especially in Queensland and New South Wales and other states, but also in the Australian Capital Territory, where the great majority of the privately occupied land in the ACT is held as a land lease from the government, usually on a term of 99 years. So what we find is that there are actually at least three different major classes, and between them they add up to covering just about all privately occupied land in Australia, either directly in terms of state leasehold or indirectly as state land taxes or the local government rates. Before we explore taxation in detail, we'll first need to go back over some very fundamental aspects of economics. We're going to begin by looking at the market. The first thing about the market is that we're familiar with the notions of supply and demand. And if pressed, we'll say that we're also aware that price is what happens in the marketplace when supply equals demand. However, we need to look a little bit more detailed at how this process works. First of all, production is motivated when an object of desire, and that is something that we want, has a greater utility, in other words, a value or a benefit to us, than its cost to produce. And when we're talking about cost to produce, we're always talking about the normal cost to produce. And the difference between the lean cost to produce and the normal cost to produce is that the normal cost of production includes a reasonable return to the producer, to the business owner, to the entrepreneur, and so on. However, this simple reality, objects of desire having greater utility than cost to produce, doesn't solve the market problem. And the market problem ultimately is the question of price. So far we've introduced two concepts, value, which is the utility or the benefit to the user, the end owner, and cost, or the pain, the difficulty, the toil and trouble caused in the process of production. But we haven't mentioned price. In the market, the question of price is the most important question, because that is really the question that gives us the transaction that brings home these objects of desire. All we can say initially is that the price is going to be somewhere between those two limits, the limit of value, in other words the benefit to the user, and the cost, the normal cost of production to the producer, to the supplier. We don't actually know exactly where in between those the market price is going to fall. They only form limits, vague limits. However, we can look a little bit more closely at those limits. If the price is moved all the way up so that the market charges for that object of desire, the entire value of it to the user, it means the user isn't really very much better off as a result of having that object of desire or not having it, because the benefit of owning it is entirely negated by the price, the money that has to be paid usually, of obtaining it. And this means that the user would only buy it if they really needed it. And this notion of need becomes important, because we're no longer simply talking about some arbitrary desire, some frill or tassel to our life that we don't really need, but we'd merely like. We're talking about things that one way or another our life wouldn't quite be the same without, perhaps even totally necessary. When a supplier randomly or at will charges a price which is equal to, or close to equal to, the value to the user, usually that only happens in a case of a monopoly situation. And that is a situation where the supplier has so much power in the marketplace, they can set the price wherever they like. Well, to say that the monopolist can set the price wherever they like is not exactly true. Because, remember, production for exchange only happens when the utility of the object is greater than its cost to produce, or at least its price. What that means is that I simply won't buy something if its price is greater than its utility or its benefit to me, unless I have extraordinary need. But even then, in a sense, it simply is saying that my utility, my need, is very great, and so therefore is the price I'm willing to pay. And so somebody starving to death out in the wilderness is willing to pay a king's ransom for a plate of food. That is because their desire, their need, the utility of that plate of food means life itself. And so the person starving to death is willing to pay an extraordinary amount. Now, normally food isn't that expensive. However, if there's only one person available to supply the food to that starving person, the starving person is going to pay whatever they want. Somehow, we feel that's a little bit unfair when the supplier, the seller, the monopolist, sets their price so high that they take all the benefit, if you like, and leave the starving person only just alive, and certainly free of all of their wealth and saving. Generally, there is a community understanding or belief that the monopoly trader, when he abuses his monopoly power to exploit the community by setting price so high, is in some way exploiting the community. If we go deeply into economic theory, we find that there is a lot of mechanisms whereby in a monopoly situation you see that the economy actually goes along quite badly. You don't have very much economic growth, and by and large the economy will be a failure when you have monopoly trading in any great extent. The other limit, however, is curious. That's the lower limit, the normal cost of production. The normal cost of production sets the lower limit for market price. If the market price falls below the normal cost of production, simply the businesses, the suppliers that make the things and bring them to market will stop bringing them to market. They'll go out of business. And so there will be no trade. This provides the floor to market price. So long as the normal cost of production includes a reasonable return to the producer and the supplier, then the market price can fall to this level without driving the supplier out of business or out of the marketplace. When we look more deeply at the implications of market price set as low as the normal cost, we find that not only do the businesses not go out of production and leave the market, but in fact the economy in general flourishes for many, many reasons. And so we find we have these two limits. The upper limit, which is the monopoly exploitation limit, and the lower limit, which is the community optimum, which leads to economic prosperity and supports sustainable businesses. The reality, however, is not quite so clear-cut. Price tends to be situation-dependent. It usually is somewhere between these two limits. It's an increment above the normal cost of production, but it usually doesn't get up near to the level of demand or the full utility value. Economists give the name for the gap between the normal cost of production and the market price the name of economic rent. And property economists immediately should have their antenna raised, because we're using this word rent. And we think, well, what's economic rent compared to land rent? It turns out that land rent is, when we look closely at it, a special case of economic rent. However, we're getting a little ahead of ourselves. For the moment, we will content ourselves to note that when price is set above the normal cost of production due to the market power of the supplier, the result is a situation of economic rent, and economic rent itself can be taken as an index of market inefficiency. We're now in a position to come back and look a little bit more closely at these market functions of supply and demand. We have seen that demand is actually the need of the buyer. When we look closely, we find that in economics, the demand is not simply the physical need of the buyer. The demand that an economist is interested in is what is known as effective demand. And that's only the demand which can be translated or expressed in dollar terms. And so a hungry man with no money is going to starve to death, and from an economist's point of view, exhibits no demand for food at all, because he can't wave a fist of dollars in front of someone supplying food. No demand, because there's no money. Because in economics, demand equals effective demand, or the number of dollars that the purchaser is willing to pay to purchase some object in the market. When we look at supply, the supply function is itself quite a complicated creature, and usually in economic theory explained by way of the marginal theory of the firm. Now, however, anyone who looks closely at the theory of the firm, the marginal theory of the firm, will find that the marginal theory of the firm, as explained to young economists, doesn't work in reality. The reality is that supply is really an index of the control, the expectations, the market power of the supplier. We won't go too far into the detail of this. However, the fact that the supply line typically runs considerably above the normal cost of production line means this, that the seller, even though they have the capacity to supply at a price equal to the normal cost of production, for whatever reason, set their expectations, in this case the green supply line, well above the normal cost of production. And they do that because they are of the opinion that the market will support these superior prices. What this means is that the familiar supply and demand functions, the crisscross market lines that we see so often in economic textbooks and elsewhere, is not so much an economic reality or an economic law or function, but it's a balance of negotiating power in the marketplace. And we find that that negotiating power is one way or another related to the balance between the quantity of goods brought to market and the need of both the supplier and the demander, the purchaser, to either sell their goods in order to keep body and soul together on the part of the supplier, or buy the goods because they have direct need of them in the case of demand. And this is really a psychological or a political power balance or a negotiating balance. And we can see this fairly evidently very often in the real estate market, where although we talk about supply and demand as factors, and certainly they are, largely because they fuel the power balance between the parties, the buyers and the seller of real estate, or the leases and tenants, ultimately, this reality of the political power balance is what tends to drive the market. The support of market prices above the normal cost of production, in other words, the ability to support a stable economic rent, is largely an indication of the fact that in most cases, supply has the dominant market power. Because after all, the demanders, the purchasers, would prefer to purchase at a lower price. And so if they had the power, they would take prices lower towards the normal cost of production. However, the fact that the typical market price in the typical market is well above the normal cost of production says that the power balance lies with supply. This is realized to be suboptimal in the economy. That means that the economy does not flourish as well in this kind of an environment as it would if the prices were closer to the NCP, the nominal cost of production. The market power is negated when we have a large number of participants, especially a large number of suppliers, but also a large number of purchasers. And so we posit that if we can have a market which has a large number of participants, especially if they have full knowledge, so they're not going to be swindled, and they act rationally, so they're not given to the passions, especially as motivated and groomed through marketing and advertising. And especially if these large number of participants are fully mobile. And what that means is that they participate in the market, they go to buy or sell, merely at whim. They don't have to, they do it because they'd like to, not because they have to. If we have these four conditions, a large number of fully rational, fully mobile, and fully knowledgeable participants, we have what is known as a perfect market. And in a perfect market, because of the mobility, the knowledge, the rationality, and the large number of participants, the price will be competed down successively down to very close to the normal cost of production. And so the perfect market, which is the ideal and in fact the very foundation of just about all of our economic thought and the assumption which lurks behind most of the economic theory found in at least general economics textbooks, is that this perfect market is the way that actual markets work. And in the perfect market, prices are competed down to normal levels, to the normal cost of production. Now, we've seen that actual markets contain economic rents. And what this means is that actual markets do not behave the way that economics textbooks say that the market must work. And in fact, whenever an economist says that through competition, such and such an economic problem will be resolved, whether it's the overprice for steel or mobile phone fees, what they're saying is that if we have market competition to the extent that it causes a perfect market to result in that particular commodity, then we'll have the problem solved and we'll have the optimum economic output. We will have equity and prosperity across the economy and stimulus. However, actual markets contain economic rents. And what this means is that they contain these imperfections, this blockage. We've said that land rents seem to have something to do with economic rents. And in fact, land value is the ultimate destination of economic rents. It's the perfect economic rent, if you like. However, land rent only gets to appropriate all of the economic rent when you have a situation of perfect market competition. And so here we have an explanation for land values. In other words, they absorb the economic rents. However, the efficiency with which they do it is dependent on how close to a perfect market the other things being traded in the marketplace are. To examine the behavior of land rents, we're going to look at a very simple example. We're going to look at the example of the pricing of quarry materials, maybe gravel or sand, taken out of a quarry. And the first situation we are going to consider is the situation where the quarry is part of the common property, public land, free land, maybe the public beach or something. We can now ask ourselves, what would be the price of sand or river gravel if it was taken out of public land, where anyone could simply go in and take it out themselves for free, if you like? Okay. The answer is not actually free. For me to get a truckload of sand into my backyard is not going to be free, because I have to, one way or another, go to the toil and trouble of going down to the river or the beach, digging up the sand, putting it in the truck, and bringing it back and dumping it in my backyard. There's a fair bit of labour involved in that activity. However, if anyone can go down to the river and do that, I can either decide to do it myself, in which case I spend that time and trouble myself, or I may employ somebody to go and do that for me. In which case, the cost of those quarry materials, the sand or the gravel, is going to cost me very close to the ultimate labour cost of getting the sand or the gravel out of the quarry and bring it back to me. And so what that means is the cost, because there are going to be lots of people that may be able to go along and dig up the sand for me, apart from myself, and because of competition, they're all going to end up only charging as much as is reasonable to support their labour costs. The price of those quarry materials, so long as the quarry is public, common land, is never going to be more than the normal cost of production. However, let's look at the situation where we now privatise the quarry. And this might be the situation where we make it illegal for people to take sand away from the beach unless they have a permit. Or maybe where you're given a right to mine or quarry the river gravel in the local river. What can we charge now for the rent on the quarry? Well, quite simply, given that I might have a particular need, a particular desire for the sand or the river gravel in my backyard, I'm willing to pay not only the labour to go and get the river gravel into my backyard, but also this extra, this gap between the labour cost and the utility value that I might place on having that gravel, that quarry material in my backyard. And that gap between the labour cost and my willingness to pay, my effective demand, will end up being the land rent, the charge that the quarry owner will be able to apply to people taking materials out of their quarry. And so what we see is that the normal cost of production expressed in labour terms is now exceeded by the rent or the payment for the use of the land applicable in this particular situation, in this case, a quarry material. So long as there is a reasonable number of able-bodied people in the community, we can conclude that the labour market is going to be relatively efficient. In other words, there's going to be a large number of participants willing to get the quarry material for me, do the digging and the carting and so on. And as long as they're not prevented by some other licensing or restriction, maybe the restricted access to a truck or a wheelbarrow, whatever it takes, that labour market is going to be fairly efficient. And the more efficient the labour market is, the more evenly labour will end up reducing that cost down to the normal cost of production. However, land is a relatively inefficient market. There is only one river in our example, or one beach, whatever, and it's limited, especially in our example, by the fact that the community has decided to privatise it. They have given private property rights to an individual, some legal entity, to be able to determine who uses the quarry. And that means that land becomes a relatively inefficient market. In many other ways, land is an inefficient market, not merely because of the limited number of rivers or beaches, but merely the fact that land is always spatially fixed. And this means that there will be one block of land that will have better views than another block of land. And even if we look at an entire township, there must be some blocks of land that will be closer to the CBD, and some that are out on the fringe, some that might have views, some that don't, and largely we can't change that. And so always the land market is to some extent inefficient. It always will have different rents or economic rents attached to it. In a perfect market, in that case, the land will absorb the excess demand. So in other words, the value that we're willing to pay above the labour cost, because labour is able to be relatively efficiently competed down in most markets. Another way of expressing that is that land value is a perfect residue in this situation, because it's always this gap, this residue, which is left once the labour cost is deducted from the utility value. Well, we've introduced this concept by looking at quarry products. We can look at any other land use because it all behaves the same. If it were the case, for instance, that there was an infinite supply of fertile farmland, the cost of all farm products would be the cost of farming them, the cost of the labour and, to a certain extent, the capital costs involved in having the farm work. There would be no land value. However, farming land is limited in supply and limited in quality. We also find similar things with commercial land for offices. Some offices are better placed than others. The same with shops, especially with shops, because shops need to be located where people are moving about in a situation where they can drop in and buy things. And we find it in residential markets. So all of our land markets, all of our property markets, are all affected by the spatial nature of land and therefore by the inefficiency of the land market. And that's why all the markets get their values. From this example of the quarry, we can further explore the distinction between the occupant of the property, of the land, and the owner of the land. While we've described the quarry owner as somehow being able to shut the gate, it could be that the quarry business has been leased, say, from the government or from somebody to the person who's actually going to be doing the digging and the carting. And that would be the person that runs the business based on the effective land use, the highest and best use of the quarry itself. Now, what I want to do is get us to look at the distribution of benefits between the occupant as tenant and the landowner. First of all, if we look at any piece of productive land as occupied by a tenant, we see that while the highest and best use of that piece of land, say as a factory site or as a farm, produces a certain level of product, of return, the occupant is able to work the land, hopefully to the highest and best use. However, they will have to pay a certain amount of rent. And so what that means is that their net benefit from occupying the land is actually reduced somewhat. And so out of the total benefits of occupation, their net benefit is only enough to really cover their living expenses and make it worth their while to run their businesses, cover their labour costs, we would say. The remainder, the residue, is able to flow to the owner. And the owner of the land is able to charge rent up to the point where the tenant says, "This is simply not worthwhile for me to run my business from here, I will leave." Or, "It's simply not worthwhile for me to pay rent on this house because it's causing me to have a very low standard of living. I don't have enough money to spend on the rest of the things, food and sending the kids to school and all the rest of it. I'm going to leave." And so the landlord is able to enjoy the benefit, the residual productivity, above what the occupant as tenant is willing to surrender in order to have a basic standard of living or a basic level of profit. This distinction between the benefit to the tenant as occupier and benefit to the landowner as residual is not so apparent when we consider owner-occupants. Maybe the farmer who lives on his own land, or the factory or the business that uses its own factory land, or whatever, the shopkeeper who owns their own shop. However, we can make this distinction even in cases of owner occupation, because to a certain extent, the occupant, say the farmer, can distinguish between that part of their farming income, which is due to their labour and effort running their farming business, and that part of their farming income that would, in other situations, be given to the landowner if they were a share farmer, if they were leasing the farm. It just happens that the owner-occupier is able to benefit directly from both of those increments, the labour cost or the return for the occupant to run their business, and the rent. In the case of owner-occupants, we describe their situation as earning or enjoying an imputed rent. And what that means is the farmer who farms his own land earns an income which is partly a return for his labour and operating his farming business, and also an equivalent rent or an implicit rent, what's called an imputed rent, the rent that he could charge another person who might come in as a tenant if he was to maybe retire from active farming and simply let some other tenant come in and run the business for him. So this notion of imputed rent means that even owner-occupants are basing their benefits, certainly their additional benefits, on the fact of an implicit, a hidden rental value. When we look at these two cases, the tenant and the owner-occupant, we see that the residual productivity, in other words, the benefit, the profit, the economic incentive for owning land, always flows to the owner, regardless of whether they're operating as an investor, a landlord, or whether they're operating as an owner-occupant. The residual productivity always flows to the landowner. So far, we've been talking primarily in terms of rent. And we'll continue to focus on rent, because rent is the active participation of the land in the productive use of the land. And so we're going to be assuming largely highest and best use, the HABU, and we're going to be looking at the way that that translates into land rent. However, where does land value come from? Well, land value is understood as the advance payment for the future rents, the upfront payment for future rents, or in the way that a financial analyst would express it, the present value of the future returns of the land. We see this especially in the capitalization approach to valuation, where land value is seen as the rent divided by the yield. One way or another, land values are derived from the rent. The rent is not derived from the land value. And that is because the rent is what comes primarily as a result of the active economic use of the property. The more advanced discounted cash flow approaches that are now becoming common are merely a more detailed evaluation of the present value of the future returns, which is really a high-powered form of capitalization. For this reason, we don't need to focus so much on land values, so long as we're following the way that land rents are operating, because one way or another, land values will follow. So for this theoretical discussion, we'll be focusing primarily on land rents, and I'll leave it up to you to think back on the impacts on land values. We'll also be talking about land rent, even in situations that are more likely going to be cases of owner occupation. And this is because of these imputed rents that lurk even in the owner occupation situation. When we look at land use in practice, we find that land is not all uniform. There is not some simple relationship between the land and labour involved in productive land use. And this is because there are different qualities of land. We mentioned before the farms that are in good quality versus those that are less productive, maybe further away or on poorer soil. What we find is that the more productive land is more valuable in exact proportion to its excess production. And what this means is that if my revenue from operating a shop is going to be higher in one location than another, then the difference between the rental value of those two shop locations is going to be exactly the difference of net profit to the business. as a result of operating in one business compared to another. However, once we look at the entire land market, what we find is that because labour is relatively constant in terms of its overall return, the labour return from occupying those two shops is going to be similar. The difference in the productivity is all going to go to the land rent. And so what this means is that across your entire property market, regardless of where you operate your shop, or in fact, even when we go between shops and factories and farms, the return to labour is largely equalised across the community. And the precision of that equalisation is largely dependent on how close to a perfect market the particular land use is. This gives rise to an expression that is used to describe this phenomenon called the wages line. And the wages line is an important theoretical construct that tends to be relatively evident in the real world, even given the level of market inefficiency. The wages line is simply that recognition that regardless of what quality of land is being used, the return to wages and enterprise, in other words, the productive activities in the community, are largely equalised. Not only are they equalised, but they are ultimately independent of the quality of the land being used. One of the curiosities of this fact is that the productive activity, the activities of the tenants, the occupants of the land, is largely independent of the quality of the land and, in fact, the destination of where the rent is going. It doesn't matter to a shopkeeper whether he is paying rent to the man next door or some person on the other side of the world. He is still paying rent. And the same is the case for the person renting a house or a factory or a farm. And what this means is that the destination of the rent does not actually affect the economy. The productive activities, the ability of the economy to produce the goods and services needed to cause the community to flourish materially, are not affected by where the rent goes. This is very important when we come to taxation. However, we'll come back to this point shortly. When we look at the question of taxation of labour and enterprise, in other words, taxation of those components, those factors of production that lie underneath the wages line, we have a little problem with definition. You'll recall that earlier we outlined the way that the return to those factors, they are the actual productive parts of the economy, and while we refer to them generally as labour, they actually refer to not just labour, but all productive activities. That includes physical labour, intellectual activity, management, entrepreneurship. In fact, all productive activities in the economy are here underneath the wages line. And so, predominantly, these include labour as wages, but also profits for business owners. We can interpret both of these as having a normal cost of production. The labourer must be able to earn sufficient to be able to maintain the livelihood of his household. Or one way or another, the household income must be sufficient to support those members of the household. Likewise, the profit to a business must be sufficient to be able to make it worthwhile running that business rather than simply closing shop and going on the dole or maybe going out and working as a labourer. And so we can see that both labour and enterprise both have a notion of subsistence. And in both cases, they're levelled by what we're calling the wages line, which is really the natural impact of rent across the market in a perfectly competitive economy. Now we look at the question of taxation. Taxation comes to the labourer, or in fact the business operator, as an additional living cost or business cost. Now, this is important because we've already said that labour and enterprise, because of the nature and the mechanics of rent, will only be earning subsistence. We need to have a little bit of a think about how subsistence works here, because subsistence is ultimately socially determined. To live at a base level in Australia means we expect to have glass in our windows and usually carpet on our floors. That's the basic expectations of life, perhaps having electricity and a telephone connected. However, this would be quite luxurious living in many other parts of the world, including some parts of the world not very far away from our own country. If we were to get to a point where, say, the average Australian wasn't able to afford to live in such a way that they could take a hot shower every day, we would be complaining to our political representatives. It would be unthinkable for our subsistence level to fall that low. Now, if one way or another, the natural operation of the rental market, the property market, is to set property rents at such a point that the return to the labourer and the business operator is operating simply at subsistence, what happens when we add taxation? If we add GST, for instance, that immediately reduces our net income by about 10%, and we can ignore the frills and tassels and the complications of the GST. If before the GST we were only living at subsistence, after the GST we must be living about 10% below subsistence. In other words, we can't survive, or at least not survive at the standard of living that our community considers appropriate. What this means is that any imposition of taxation is going to be very, very hard for labour and enterprise to tolerate. In this theoretical model, what will tend to happen is that it will cause tenants, whether they be individuals or businesses, to militate to reduce the amount of rent that they pay. This may not be noticeable in terms of rents actually falling, but it will certainly be the case that as taxes little by little increase, the impact of increasing taxation will be to stall growth in rents. And so over a period of time, if you introduce a new tax, what you would expect to find is that rents will stop growing, and they'll stop growing for long enough for them to eventually find a new relativity compared to wages and profits. What's really happening is that the taxation, which might be taken out of the labourer's pocket or the business operator's pocket, is actually being transferred into the property market because it's constraining the growth of rents and therefore constraining the growth of land values. What this means is that regardless of how I initially take my taxation, as income tax or as GST or payroll tax or some other form of taxation, ultimately it will impact on the entire economy by constraining the growth in land rents, and therefore it will be ultimately taken out of what otherwise would have gone in land rent. What will be seen in the community in terms of visible data will be an increase in wages and profits. This creeping effect of taxes being transferred from individuals and businesses back into the property market is not immediately apparent. What is apparent is that when a tax is imposed, one way or another, if the community is going to maintain its standard of living, it will militate for wages and profit increases in the medium or longer term. And this will appear to raise the wages line, and there will be an apparent higher level of wages in the community. However, as we've seen, this is really negated by the impact of the taxation. What we find more difficult to directly observe is that the rents that may have been applicable after that transfer has affected will not have grown nearly as much as they would have otherwise. And in this way, the taxation has actually been transferred into the property market, even though it may not be apparent in any particular observation that we may be able to make. Another way of looking at this is to look at what happens when a tax is removed. And we certainly see this impact on the real estate market. If the government was to reduce our level of taxation, it would not be terribly long before we would see property values increasing. And remember, we said that when you see property values increasing, that's really on the back of the reality that property values are closely related to land rents. And so if taxes fall, which they seldom do, what we would expect to see is that the property market is stimulated. And we have had a number of instances of where the government has done this in the past in order to stimulate the economy. And usually a property boom is always shortly following. To understand the reality of what's going on, though, we need to be aware that even though it may be difficult to observe directly, the actual wages line hasn't moved a great deal through this process. The new taxes come in, maybe wages and profits have been temporarily subdued, but over a period of time they're built up one way or another. They appear to be higher than they started with, but the overall situation of the labourer or the business owner is not that much different to where they first started. And we can certainly see this in the case of the GST and things like payroll taxes and so on. Overall, what we've seen illustrated here in this diagram and this process is the proof of the assertion that we made at the outset that all taxes on labour and profits eventually come out of land values. However, this simple assertion, while it works in a perfect market, does actually assume a perfect market. And so it means that if we did have perfect markets, the type of tax is absolutely irrelevant. So why is the type of taxation such a big deal politically? Well, this comes back to one of the implications of the assumption of the perfect market, and also the notion that labour and capital have fixed subsistence levels, and to a certain extent the reality of the fact that the effects are not instant. All of these assumptions are actually problematic. The processes tend to work over a fair period of time. We also find that business owners are fairly tolerant when their profits are squeezed a bit. While they may not like it, they don't immediately go out of business. And likewise, we can see a lot of resilience in the labour market. Wages can be squeezed, and standards of living can be constrained a fair way before there is a meaningful reaction or rebellion. What this means is that the threshold of subsistence is rather fluid. And so you can have taxes that push down real wages, and you can have taxes that do attack particular parts of the productive economy. And so they will suffer standard of living depression or perhaps profit level imbalances, and these will appear to be relatively fixed. However, even with this case, what tends to happen in the longer term, however, despite these short-term distortions, is that overall the balance of wages and incomes and profits across the economy does tend to find a long-term equilibrium. However, actually observing the attachment, the association between a particular tax and how precisely it's worked eventually into land rents is relatively difficult. And the reality in an imperfect market is somewhere in between, that there are changes in the relative standard of living between those who earn their income from property and those who earn their income from other things, and those do tend to change as a result of changes to things like taxation. However, ultimately, the general impact is still labour or the productive economy versus land investment. We've looked at the way that various taxes will produce various effects of driving down standards of living, perhaps below our notional socially determined idea of subsistence in different quarters of the society. What are the impacts of a land tax? Fairly simply, a land tax reduces the effective net land rent. As a land tax becomes more important in the community, it tends to stabilise land values. This is something which is almost forgotten in our part of history, where property is largely owned with an eye to capital gain, as though it's a necessary and natural part of property ownership. However, we only have to go back in history, say before about 1970, and we find the primary reason for owning property was either to occupy it yourself or in order to earn a rental yield. In other words, the ownership objectives in owning property changed somewhere around the last quarter of the 20th century. Today, this habit of land values having strong capital appreciation is something that deserves a certain amount of review. For the present, however, we'll simply note that a land tax will tend to stabilise the trend of land values, and it will tend to make property ownership more yield-dependent than capital gain-dependent. A little bit of reflection will show that this actually reduces the level of risk to the property investor and overall increases the general economic efficiency. A third impact of land tax, or rather a non-impact of it, is that land tax does not discourage productive activity. You'll recall that we noted earlier that it doesn't matter to whom the tenant, the shopkeeper, the factory owner, the farmer, pays the rent. And this means it's not going to affect the shopkeeper or the factory owner or the farmer in terms of their productive activities, whether the rent is going into a private investor, either locally or overseas, or whether a slice of that land rent is going across to the government as a part of the land tax. The existence of a land tax means that there is a fixed regular cost associated with owning land. And this means that the landowner has a strong incentive to use the land productively. In fact, to use the land at its highest and best use. And so land tax is associated with the optimum utilisation of an economy's land resources. The fifth aspect of land tax, which is worth mentioning initially, is that a land tax cannot be passed on, at least over the longer term. It's curious that when you see calls for an increase in land tax in the community, the level of political reaction is largely on the basis that it will make it impossible for people to be able to rent houses, and it will militate against the weaker and poorer in the economy. However, this is not strictly true. Generally, in a well-operating property market, rents are set by the capacity of the tenant. If a land rent is imposed, the rental properties will not disappear, and the owners will still find the most productive use of their property is to offer it for rent. And if the rent is already at the top end of what the tenant can afford, it's simply not going to be possible for them to pay more. If it was possible for them to pay more, even in the absence of a land tax, you would probably find that rents would have risen. From these various arguments, we can see that land tax cannot be passed on in the long term. This is not to say that it's not passed on in the short term. However, from our discussion of subsistence in an earlier slide, we can see that this short-term effect really is at the expense of the pattern of long-term rental growth into the future. Next, we can look at the impact of land tax on investment. If the capital growth in the property market is going to be a little more sober than it was previously, this can encourage new investment into productive activity. And this means rather than speculating on the property market, which might be a benefit for some property professionals, overall this kind of investment doesn't actually employ anybody or put any more machines or factories to work in the economy. However, if property investment becomes less attractive, the necessary conclusion is that those investment dollars are going to move into more productive activity, into direct investment in the productive sectors of the economy. This would mean a stimulus for employment-related activities and directly productive activities, all of which lead to an improvement in the standard of living across the community. Land tax tends to discourage speculative investment, and this is largely on the back of the fact that it stabilizes land values. If land values are stabilized, and depending on what the terms of the land tax are, we can find that the whole area of speculation is discouraged. Generally, in an economy, while a speculator may be able to make handsome profits for themselves, the overall impact is to stimulate higher prices for the general community without actually producing anything. And so from an economic point of view, the discouragement of speculative investment is actually an advantage. Largely, the GFC would not have happened if it wasn't for the speculative investment that happened in all the countries that it was hit by. These include the United States and, of course, the BRICS countries. A third major impact on investment is a stimulation in consumer demand. And this is because if an economy moves towards earning more income from land tax and less from other taxes, then it means that, by and large, the average consumer will have more disposable income. This relies on looking at the overall balance of who is affected by a land tax. It's one thing to consider the impacts of land tax, but there's also the matter of collection issues. There are a number of curious things about land tax at present in most states of Australia. Land tax is considered to be an expensive tax to collect. And this is because in order to collect land tax, you need to maintain a state valuation capacity. However, the state valuation service, regardless of which state it is largely a fixed cost. It's going to perform pretty much the same duties and have the same overall cost of operation, regardless of whether the land tax level is high or low. If the land tax level is increased, the cost of collection remains stable, static, unchanged. And this means that the higher the percentage of land tax that a community collects, the cheaper it is to collect. There are a number of other aspects to the collection of land tax. Firstly, because land is spatially fixed and quite evident who the owner is because of the state registers of ownership, it's an extremely difficult tax to avoid. And this overcomes many of the problems in the income tax legislation that were supposed to be overcome by the GST but weren't, and that is the problem of tax avoidance. Land tax is considerably easier to compute than most other taxes. Land values are fairly evident, and while we might bicker over the minutiae of the precise level of a particular block of land, overall the fabric of pattern of land values over a community is fairly evident, and certainly it's relatively straightforward matter to be able to put some kind of relativity between this block of land and the next for the purposes of taxation. Land tax is quite inexpensive to collect because, unlike other taxes that have considerable accounting overheads in order to collect them, especially we see this with GST and income tax, land tax is simply a matter of deciding on a rate and then applying it to the established values and charging the owner. And so this means that the owner does not have any onerous obligations as far as having an army of accountants to go and do their books for them. And likewise, the state doesn't have the same level of surveillance issues. And so it's inexpensive to collect because compliance is inexpensive to supervise. Likewise, because land values are fairly well known, especially compared to incomes or all of the other machinations that go behind taxes like the GST, the level of land tax is relatively certain. And one of the delightful things about land tax is that it's quite manageable for the person paying the land tax. If I want to pay a lot of land tax, I own a lot of land. If I want to pay a small amount of land tax, I invest my money in some other part of the economy. And so it means that I get to choose whether I pay a large amount of tax or a small amount of tax. I can manage it. And because it's difficult to avoid and simple to compute and so on, the level of land tax is quite certain, particularly with respect to the other major forms of taxation that we've been discussing. So far we've been looking at the matter of land tax as a general possibility and its comparison to other taxation. Here I'd like to dwell a little on the matter of infrastructure. Overall, communities understand that infrastructure increases productivity. It provides certain short-term benefits to the occupants of a country or a community. If we build a road or a railway, it's going to increase the productivity and the standard of living of those people living near the infrastructure. However, the longer-term impact is curious, because if living near the new infrastructure makes life more profitable or pleasant to live, that is going to lead to the land rents and values increasing. The fact that paying more rent because I live near a new freeway or a new electric railway means that the net improvement in my standard of living is actually being reduced by the additional rents that I'm paying. In this way, what we can see is the long-term impact of infrastructure is actually to increase the rents on the land in the vicinity of the infrastructure. And so the net benefit, it tends to be taken away from the tenant and the user and tends to find its way into the landowner's pockets as increased rents. This leads to a curiosity when it comes to the matter of paying for infrastructure. While there's a general notion that if the community, say the state, builds new roads and railways, everyone in the community is going to benefit, and therefore we should all pay, say through our income tax. However, what we've just been arguing, and what we can see by looking at any one of a large number of examples in the community, is that the ultimate net beneficiary tends to be the landlord, the landowner. It means that there's a curiosity when it comes to how we should pay for these things. If the tenant is paying by way of, say, the usage charges for the new infrastructure, say, a new railway where they have to pay for their tickets, they actually end up paying twice for the new infrastructure. They pay first as a use charge, say by the railway tickets or whatever. But then they pay a second time in terms of additional rents. Meanwhile, the landowner doesn't pay for the infrastructure necessarily at all, or at least not to the same degree. And in fact, from the tenant's point of view, if the infrastructure is initially constructed by using general taxation, the poor old tenant is probably paying for the infrastructure a third time as well, and that is through their general taxes. A deeper and probably more precise approach to the user pays dictum is to recognise that the land is the primary beneficiary of infrastructure, and this means that the landowner is also the primary beneficiary, or in fact, the effective user, certainly the effective economic user. This would imply that the landowner should pay for it. If infrastructure is benefiting or has the impact of increasing land values, it means that the land value is not something that simply comes by magic out of the sky. It comes as a result of the activity of the community. It's quite easy to see then that if the community produces something, let's say increased land values, it's a matter of natural justice that the community should be able to recoup at least part of that material economic benefit, at least to be able to pay for the thing in the first place. This would suggest that a land tax that is placed on the community in order to pay for infrastructure is in fact not strictly speaking a tax at all. It is simply the community recouping what it has spent to benefit the landowner in terms of increased land values. We certainly see this in the case of local government rates. There was a time when to act as a developer simply meant that you would take a paddock somewhere, draw some lines on a plan of that paddock, and be able to sell the lots. And this is because local government rates were sufficiently high and sufficiently well tied to the provision of local infrastructure, say in terms of roads and so on, that if the local council was to build the road, that would result in the value of that development land, that new lots in the development land, becoming more valuable. And by becoming more valuable, the council was able to charge more rates, and the greater level of rates were able to pay for their investment in building the roads. And for this reason, through most of the early part of the 20th century, local government was able to provide infrastructure such as local roads and so on purely out of their local rates, and they didn't need to impose demands on developers to actually do the construction themselves. However, as local government became more dependent on state and Commonwealth funding, it meant this nexus, this connection between the quality of the infrastructure they provided and their own levels of local income through their local government rates, which were tied to land values. As that nexus was broken, then local government started to see the provision of local infrastructure as a cost and a burden, something to be avoided wherever possible, rather than an investment that actually increased its net overall income. And so we find today there is a plethora of expectations placed on developers to build not only infrastructure within subdivisions, but also pay for related infrastructure or necessary infrastructure outside the boundaries of a particular development area. It's one of the examples of the failure of land tax to be able to effectively recoup what the community has put into or contributed to the increase in local land values. Once we can see the connection between infrastructure and land values, and after all, any property economist worth their salt can spot the opportunities that come when infrastructure is announced. We can then apply the same insights to the whole question of the way that the community itself contributes to land values. And in fact, when we look closely, what we find is that in a modern society that doesn't rely too heavily on agriculture, urban land values, which is to say the greater share of the most productive land in the community, are just about entirely dependent on the community itself for the very support of their value. And this is because the population and or its economic strength is the very reason that people want to locate in a particular place. If somebody wants to live in Rockhampton or Brisbane or Sydney, they partly do it because by doing that, they will be close to a centre that will be able to offer them many, many things. These include employment and also a vast array of goods and services that aren't nearly as comfortably available in other parts of the country, especially as we get into more remote areas. And what this means is that the short-term effect of moving into the city or choosing to live in a city is that it increases your effective standard of living. This is because you don't have to work so hard to be able to live comfortably in the city. You will find that you'll be able to get around more easily because of public transport and good road connections. You'll be able to communicate more easily because of better access to a whole variety of communications facilities. Your entertainment will be superior because there'll be everything from restaurants to plays to concerts to you name it available. Your children will have better schools, and if any part of your family is ill, you'll have access to better hospitals and medical care. All of these things contribute to a standard of living. Now, we tend to differentiate between standard of living, which is the quality of life, and our income or our wages. But essentially, they really come down to the same thing. After all, the reason most of us go to work or earn a wage or some other form of income is so that we can live comfortably. And so, one way or another, the advantages of living in a strong community, either a large community or one that has some significant economic strength, is that it implicitly increases our income, if we understand income to be that mechanism that we use ultimately to support our standard of living. Now, we can talk about a short-term income. Short-term income is that, yes, it is very nice to live in a developed area. However, the long-term effect, though, is not quite so bright. Because if I choose to live in Rockhampton rather than, say, some small town, especially out in the region somewhere, not perhaps distorted by the effects of the current mining boom, I will find that I have to pay a lot more to buy a house in a reasonable-sized regional city. If I want to live with similar access to, say, the CBD and other goods and services in a larger city, say Brisbane, I will find that the cost of real estate, my land rent effectively, is considerably higher. And if I go to the most expensive part of Australia to live, which is in Sydney, I find that all the attractions of living in Australia's only global city are effectively negated because of the very high cost of real estate in that place. So what's the connection here? The connection is very simple. Cities derive their value because, ultimately, of two things. The population of the centre and also its economic strength. There's no point in having a city of 4 million paupers. It won't be a very pleasant place to live, and its real estate values will be relatively low, as we see in some Asian countries. So we need this combination. Population with economic strength. Now, if the population itself and its economic strength is what gives land its value in the cities, and largely we can see that's the case, Again, if we stay with Sydney, we can say, well, Sydney is also a very beautiful city to live in. However, so is the beautiful area around Batemans Bay or many other coastal towns. In fact, in some cases, they may even have more spectacular views and better harbours. However, their land values are only a tiny fraction of what they are in Sydney, especially in the inner suburbs of that global city. So what do we have? We have the community with its economic strength causing land values to be very high. And the long-term impact of that is the net effect on one's standard of living tends to be negated somewhat. If one lives in a small regional town, sure enough, your apparent wages might be lower. But on the other hand, your cost of real estate will also be lower. And so, in many ways, you may be able to live quite comfortably. Whereas if you live in the hustle and bustle and excitement of a major urban centre, largely you still have to work very hard. So in a sense, your net standard of living isn't that much better than someone living, say, a simpler life off in some regional location. And so the long-term impact is that the increase in land rents and values tends to negate the net increase in standard of living that comes from living within a strong urban community. Now, this should not come as any surprise to you. We all know this. We all know that Sydney is the most expensive city to buy real estate in Australia. And we can see that it's largely because of the economic strength of Sydney as the location where most financial and other businesses have their head offices and so on. But this has a very direct and curious implication. And that is that the land values of urban land are the result, they are caused by the very activity of the community in its common population and common economic strength. Now there's a matter of natural justice here, and that is that naturally a thing belongs primarily to its maker. And this is an idea that has never been seriously disputed in the entire of Western economic thought. However, putting these two ideas together comes up with a rather curious conclusion. If the land values that we experience in urban centres are a result of the urban centre, it means they belong to the community, not to the individual. I might own the dirt in my backyard, but the value of the dirt comes as a result of my neighbours. If I live in Sydney, it's the result of 4.5 million neighbours. If I live in Rockhampton, it's the result of about 100,000 neighbours, and so on. Now, this has an implication for the community's funding. If I am going to support the roads in my city and so on, as we've seen with infrastructure, but also those more remote doings of the community, such as the provision of law and order, a justice system, maybe the inner coordination of the government in terms of its government departments and bureaucracy, things that aren't necessarily local, however, they have an effect on my local situation. The funding of those, the support of those, is the way that I support the existence of the community. However, the existence of the community is what gives me my land values. Obviously, if the community creates the land values, the community has a share in them. And so, the appropriate way of supporting the community is to give back to the community what the community has created, or at least a small part of it. What this suggests is that land tax appropriates for the community what the community produces. And so it, in fact, it is not a tax at all, but simply a refund. Moreover, what we've seen in the case of infrastructure, That is, the possibility of people being charged multiple times for the infrastructure when the infrastructure is not funded as some sort of a levy on local land values, we see a similar phenomenon here. That if the community is funded through charges against wages and enterprise, then the individuals that are working in the community, either as labourers or entrepreneurs or business owners, are in fact being charged double to support the very community they create and contribute to. This is because they are also simultaneously paying high land values. And the high land values come from what? They come from the success of those businesses and those labour efforts that the various members of the community contribute to. Because remember, we said that the strength of the community comes from both its numerical population and its economic strength, the success and the application of its businesses and labour activities. This perspective on land tax is quite curious, because in economics, most young economists are taught that a tax is a curious thing because it's a charge made by the government or a levy made by the government without any guarantee of a particular good or service in return. This is certainly the case for income tax, where my income tax is not necessarily spent on me in any meaningful way or even any way that I can see proportioned to my contribution to it. However, land tax is, because the amount of land tax, assuming it's proportioned to the unimproved value of the land, is proportioned exactly to the impact of the community's doing in terms of its population and economic strength on the land itself, land value. It's unfortunate that more people in the community aren't aware of this, because there is a tremendous opportunity available, which has been evident in the past to more extent than it is at present. And this is that the more contribution is made to the community, the stronger and larger the community will be, and the stronger and larger will be its economic success, and therefore the stronger and larger will be its land values. That is, contribution to the community, say by a land tax or some other form of taxation, while it's currently seen as a burden, a levy that has got no particular connection to the benefits it returns to us, is in fact not the case with land tax, because land tax is simply this refund. It means that the more land tax is collected, most probably the more intense will be the benefit to the community in the longer term. Now, we've certainly seen this in the case of infrastructure, and just to return briefly to the case of infrastructure, we can see some curious examples. One example is the case of paved roads in various rural parts of Australia. When local governments were charged with the obligation of providing road paving, but their income was tied to the land values of the land within their council areas, what we found was the benefit of paving the roads was reflected in the greater attractiveness of the land either side of those roads, and therefore increased government rates. That is, the local government was rewarded for the act of paving by being able to participate in a percentage of the benefit that came to the landowners. Everyone benefited. Basically, the landowners benefited to a large extent, and the council benefited to the extent of being able to pay for its goods and services and expand those goods and services. However, as local governments now are reliant far more on Commonwealth funding, in other words, funding that isn't tied to their performance in the provision of infrastructure, we've seen the collapse of their ability, and in fact their willingness, to supply these basic elements of infrastructure. The north coast of New South Wales is a very good example of this, largely because of the climate and the soil conditions in that part of Australia make it a very attractive place to live. But the climate, being rather wet, also makes it a difficult place to keep the roads in order. During the early years post-Second World War, the community was able to pave the roads of the councils in the northeast corner, say in Lismore and Quahogle shires, and that led to the increase in land values and an overall flourishing of that corner. However, today, because of the difficulties of funding, the councils, for instance Quahogle Council, is no longer able to comfortably maintain the roads that 50 or 60 years ago it was able to actually build from scratch. And so we've got this total reversal of fortunes, not because the Australian economy has gone back, but simply because the willingness of the community to support itself has meant that the local council no longer has the resources or the willingness to be able to invest in the local infrastructure. We see a similar thing writ large with the support of the community in general, which we're talking about here in terms of community interest. The foregoing two slides outline the way that land gets its value from these two closely interrelated processes, infrastructure and the very community itself. And we can see that one way or another, some sort of a levy on land values is a refund to the community for what it provides, either as a community itself or in terms of the infrastructure it provides. And so land tax appears to be a very robust way of funding the community's needs. However, there is a complaint about land tax, that while land value is related to infrastructure in the community, it's a difficult thing to measure because in a developed community, it's difficult to observe what the land value is separate to the improvements. And we see this as a common criticism of land value. The argument goes that we can see property value, and property values appear to be responding to infrastructure and the strengthening of the community. So why don't we simply charge our tax as a property tax? We need to look at the pros and cons of land tax versus property tax. The major problem with a property tax, in other words, a tax on the entire developed property, is that because part of the tax is paid on that value that the owner has added to the property, the tax becomes a major disincentive to the property owner investing in the developments on the property to bring the property up to its highest and best use. This was seen in Victoria some years ago, where different councils were able to levy their local government rates either on land tax or property tax, pretty much as a matter of council decision. One of the curious things that was noticed was that those councils that levied tax on the basis of land tax alone tended to be the ones where the greatest level of development occurred, whereas those that took the simpler route of levying their rates on the developed property values were actually left behind in terms of business development. And this is because land tax does not discourage in any way the active use of the land or any other activity on it. That is, land tax encourages property to be used at its highest and best use, whereas property tax is a tax on labour and enterprise, or at least that labour and enterprise that's applied to the improvements. Furthermore, if you have vacant land which is totally unused, in a property tax environment you'll simply pay less tax, and so you'll be inclined to perhaps just leave that land there and wait for capital growth to be able to return some kind of a profit. Whereas if your tax is in terms of land value alone. Leaving your land underutilized, fallow if it's rural land, means that you are paying a cost on the basis of the potential of the land, even if you're not realizing it. And so obviously it becomes rather foolish to own land and not use it at its highest and best use. This means that there is a powerful economic incentive in a land tax environment, not simply to be pained by the effect of having a tax levied on your own doings, but in fact, leaving the land underutilized means that you're paying this high rate of tax without a compensating benefit. And we find that in regimes where tax is based on a land tax rather than a property tax, development tends to be optimal. And in fact, we also find that land size tends to be rationalized. It tends to be rationalized in a way which is better proportioned to individual business needs or individual person's needs in utilizing land for the various ways that it's utilized. There are a number of other contingent benefits about land tax. They tend to discourage speculation and bubbles because they focus more investment on bringing the land up to its highest and best use, in other words, productive investment, rather than simply speculative investment. It does provide a certain valuation challenge, but not one which is insuperable for the valuation profession. And in fact, any of you will be able to identify the land value, especially after you've completed the specialized or advanced valuation components of the course. Despite the theoretical strength of land tax over property tax, there are some practical issues. Of these, the most important one is that it requires a degree of political will to endure over the long term. But especially, it requires a state valuer with a clear understanding of the issues involved in identifying land tax. And this, in practice, means that you need to have legislation which conforms to the practical and theoretical necessities for establishing this valuation paradigm over the entire area. What we've come to so far is quite a surprise. What we've discovered is that land tax is not only a good tax, but in fact it may not be a tax at all. But the idea of suddenly moving to a land tax economy is quite surprising, alarming. Many people would say it would be impossible. Let's look at the practicalities of living in a land tax economy from a couple of perspectives. The first is that if we look at the national public funding requirements for Australia, we find that at present they are less than the land rent on all private property. This means that we have in Australia the capacity to be able to change our tax base from the various taxes that exist to land rents and still be able to support the level of community services and so on that we're familiar with. The second thing I'd like to look at is what would life be for the average person if land rents were the only tax, the tax base for Australia, and there were no other taxes. For this example, I'd like to begin by looking at the example of a household. If we look at the average household, we find that the major outgoings are the household's tax obligations, their home mortgage or rent, and then after that come other expenses that are kind of more apparent and perhaps even more enjoyable, such as actually providing for food and clothing and entertainment and education and medicine and so on. But tax and housing costs are the two major ones. In general, we can estimate that for the average household, tax and housing costs make up somewhere in the vicinity of about $40,000 a year. Let's look at what happens, or what would happen, in a typical household if we were in a situation where families effectively rented their land from the government and owned their own houses. Very much the case of what happens in the Australian Capital Territory. First of all, we'd have no income tax and GST could be retired. That would give us quite a considerable benefit in terms of money in our pocket. If we look at the average household, and on the side here we look at a, well, what we'll call a typical urban property value, we're going to take as an example $300,000 for our property value. That might be a bit low for people living in Sydney, but a bit high for people living in a small regional town, but we'll take that as an average across the country. We'll assume out of this $300,000 we have a land value of, say, $200,000, and the average household has got about 60% debt. So that means out of the $300,000, well, about two-thirds is debt, so we'll say $200,000 to keep the numbers fairly round. And we'll use an interest rate of 7% and a loan term of 25 years. It means that the average household in this estimate, this generalisation, is spending about $16,900 a year repaying their home. Out of that, interest of about $14,000. We'll look at the property yield of 5%. Land rent, we can deduce, is going to be $10,000 per year. Household income, about $100,000. We're assuming a double income here on the average Australian wage. That means that the average household is currently spending $25,000 a year on tax, another $3,000 or $4,000 on GST. So they're spending a total amount on tax of close to $30,000. Now let's look at what would happen if they moved into a situation where they were paying land tax to the government, roughly the land rent value of their houses, but still with the same income. First of all, they would not have the income tax and the GST, so they'd be in front by about $28,000 in the current example. In addition to that, however, for the average household who is involved in a mortgage to buy their house, or even someone who's paying rent to an investor who is also relying on the bank to go and fund their investment property, there's a further implicit interest amount in there of about another $14,000. Now, if we were paying land tax to the government, we would only have to pay for the improvements on our house in terms of when we move into a property, because we would buy a house, but what that would mean is we obtain the rights to a particular site, which would be leasing from the government, and we would effectively buying the improvements from the previous owner. What would we be buying? Well, in our example here, we would be buying about $100,000 worth of improvements, because we've seen here the example is $300,000 for the property value, $200,000 for the land value, and so there's improvements of $100,000. Would there be any interest involved in that situation? Well, no. And so the average household in this example would immediately be in front by the $14,000 of interest that they had previously had to pay, or at least have to pay in the current environment. Overall, what this means is that if the average household paid their tax as a land tax to the government rather than through the other existing taxes, and here we've only included two of them in our consideration, there are many others that we pay, what we can see is the average household with an income of $100,000 a year is going to be something like over $30,000 a year better off because of the tax they save and also the interest they save. A $30,000 increase per annum in a household's economic situation is certainly going to help their situation. Remember also that this is going to be a household that no longer has any debt, or at least any major debt, no mortgage debt. Overall, that household is going to be able to spend a greater percentage of their income, in fact, in this example, $30,000 more of their income, on goods and services to increase or to support their standard of living. That kind of an increase in disposable income means that their standard of living is going to increase quite considerably, perhaps doubled. Their ability to save will be multiplied almost astronomically. Their inclination to invest is going to be directed more towards investment in built assets and built investments rather than speculative investments such as land. And so it means that if Australia was to move to a land tax economy, we would suddenly find that we would escape our current high levels of general indebtedness. And our households would have considerable more purchasing power. And that would be a tremendous stimulus for those sectors of the productive economy that supply the things for the consumers. And so overall, living in a land tax economy would encourage an extraordinary increase in not just property affordability, but also in the overall economic strength of the household, and for that matter, the economic strength of the country. Let's look at the impacts, or some of the impacts, of living in a land tax world. First of all, because in a land tax world, tax would only be levied on land, only those people who chose to hold land would pay tax. Now, that means that notionally, we could simply decide not to pay any tax at all by spending our savings on something apart from land. And this would be quite practical and reasonable. So if we had some savings, we might not choose to buy property, but rather invested in a business or something else. Would we escape paying any tax at all? Well, we wouldn't have escaped paying rent, because if we chose to run or invest our money, say, in a business, that business, one way or another, would need a place to operate. And that place to operate, whoever owned it, whether we owned it ourselves or the landlord that we paid rent to, would be paying tax on it. And so we'd either be paying land tax directly ourselves as owner-occupiers or as a part of our rent. However, the quality of land that we chose to live in would determine the amount of tax that we chose to pay. And so this means if we wanted to live in Sydney where values are very high, sure enough, we could enjoy the excitement and the hustle and bustle of a global city, and we would pay higher tax. If we wanted to live in a quieter and more rural environment, we would be able to pay considerably less tax. And so it would give every individual in Australia tremendous control over the amount of tax that they owed. And in amongst that, we've already seen that it would incline people to own other assets for which no tax was directly due. The advantages of the land tax world is that the whole business of collecting tax would be considerably simpler. We would no longer have to employ an army of accountants and so on to be able to manage our tax obligations and be able to respond to the reporting needs that currently are associated with the dominant taxes in the country. Tax avoidance would be very difficult. Collection would be certain. The assessment would be inexpensive. Now, I've mentioned this before. Once we have a state valuer and we have a valuation system over the entire country, which we have already, the amount of taxation that is collected is totally independent of its cost. The cost is fixed. And so the more land tax we collect, the cheaper it becomes to collect because the costs are fixed. Land tax world would have zero negative impact on productivity. Because remember, whether we're paying rent to the government or land tax to the government, or whether we're paying rent to somebody else. It doesn't affect our inclination to use the property that we're renting or owning. So it has zero negative impact on productivity. Land tax will discourage speculative incomes, which is a considerable advantage because that tends to make more funds available for productive investment. Overall, it won't change our life's activities because we're already paying rent or having to pay considerably to obtain premises for owner occupation. And so our use of land will not diminish. What will tend to happen, however, is that the land we use will tend to be used at its highest and best levels. So one way or another, the impacts of a land tax world will be more efficiency in our taxation and a more effective use of the resources that the country has available to it. If we look at some of the instances where land tax has been applied, and we find them spread across the globe, we'll look at a couple to begin with. If we look at California, in California, some counties, in other words, local government areas, use a land tax as their dominant, in fact, only form of local taxation collection. Now, the American counties are considerably more comprehensive in their scope than Australian local government areas. The experience in California has found that the result of using a land tax as their primary form of county taxation is that the land areas tend to be smaller and more efficient. That is, the land is used closer to its highest and best use, and there's more incentive for people to have economic independence. A third advantage of the Californian experience is that infrastructure is relatively easy to provide, and generally you find a better level of infrastructure provided in the land tax counties. Another example of land tax was in Denmark, where there was a national transition to land tax some years ago. When it came in, inflation was curbed almost immediately, and their national balance of payments was corrected. Not only that, employment was stimulated. Now, looking at those advantages or those economic effects, in present economic thought, they are not supposed to be able to coexist. To curb inflation usually means increasing unemployment. However, the Denmark experience was that they were able to have both. And in addition to that, their balance of payments, in other words, their international position, was strengthened. The problem with the Denmark experience, though, was that it generated quite a number of political enemies, because there are a number of people in Denmark that were profiting from the previous regime of taxation, and these eventually succeeded in being able to wrest government away from the land taxing party and back to what we might call the more common arrangement in the West at present. And almost as soon as the land tax system was taken apart, all of the problems that had plagued Denmark before returned. That is, inflation high, unemployment high, and balance of payments going very much the wrong way. The political realities are evident from these examples, and we see some others in places like Taiwan and Singapore. There is a high degree of cultural acceptance of what we could call the magic of property growth. Most people in democratic countries with Western educations believe that there is some magical thing about real estate that causes it to grow in value without any effort. And that growth in value is somehow more attractive than working for a living and something that we all aspire to. And for that reason, we have a cultural inclination to make political decisions at the voting booth which will increase capital gain in land. However, what we've seen earlier is that capital gain in land does not necessarily benefit the community in general, or even the majority of citizens. And so what we find is that the long-term realities with respect to land tax in politics is that land tax is a misunderstood tax because it is seen to diminish the potential for capital growth and therefore the opportunity for being able to earn an income without effort. And where land tax is strengthened in a community, it tends to attract considerable political opposition. And this opposition can range as far as the media and other groups that are able to influence the thinking of the community and its political representatives. Overall, what we find is the political reality with land tax is that in the longer term, it has gone from being historically the major form of taxation in the community, certainly it was the major form of taxation in all Western countries up to about the year 1900, whereas now it is becoming very much a minor player. But simultaneously, we find that economies are becoming personally, economically, and financially weaker, and we've certainly seen that in recent times with the continuing problems associated with the global financial crisis. We'll move now to what we could consider from a professional point of view a relatively selfish topic, and that is, what role would remain in the community for land economists if land tax was to become the dominant form of taxation or community funding in the economy? We've seen that property speculation and the growth of property values would both be discouraged in a land tax world. Wouldn't this mean that the majority of property economists would lose their jobs? The reality would appear to be something a little bit different. We've already mentioned a couple of times the land tax environment requires a strong and consistent, a reliable state valuer. And this means that the state valuer would basically replace what is currently done by many sections of government, such as this, the ATO, the Australian Tax Office, and also those arms of government devoted to the collection of other taxes, such as GST and the other state government taxes. And so land economists would become the dominant state officer responsible for the collection of taxation. And so from that point of view, employment would be strengthened. We would also find demand for valuers, and especially valuers are able to understand the property economics issues, to be able to work on behalf of private owners to make sure that the determinations of the state valuer were adequately checked so that owners were not overpaying their land tax. And so private practice property economics would still be strong, and in fact probably even stronger, because there would be need for regular reviews of land values. The development industry would change somewhat, and we won't go into this in this presentation. However, we would be able to say that the risks associated with property development would be reduced in a land tax environment. It would mean that consulting for the development industry would have a different profile, and that profile would be less to do with speculation and the whole question of development feasibility, and more in terms of community needs and so on. In a related way, property economists would be required to assess infrastructure proposals, because as we've seen, infrastructure is only feasible on the basis that it has a net benefit for the community. And by being able to focus more clearly on its effect on land values, there is obviously a greater role for property economists than at present. And this would spill out not just into the benefit-cost analysis for the community, but also into studies on the optimum allocation. We've mentioned development feasibility and the direction for optimum development. Again, development would be more in terms of a better understanding of highest and best use, and ensuring that the development proposals that were accepted did in fact realize highest and best use for the community as a whole. Currently, we find that land use planners are fulfilling this role, but they tend not to do it with the economic understanding of a property economist, and therefore in some cases the decisions are not necessarily optimal. Another role for property economists that could be expanded in a land tax world is the question of land use matching, and this means the optimum matching of land use to the user. We see this already in retail economics, where the positioning of shopping centres or particular shops is estimated on the basis of a quantitative application of economic theory, and these days using geographical information systems and so on to look at the likely levels of revenue available to particular retailing activities on a spatial basis. Land use matching also includes the whole activity of brokerage, the transfer of property from one to another, what in Australia is referred to as agency. Land use matching, thirdly, includes the improvement or work related to funds management or investment management, the importance of property trusts will not be diminished as a result of land tax, even though their nature will tend to be transformed largely back to the kind of investment outlook that existed about a generation or so ago, say before 1970. This is because a land tax regime will tend to incline property players to look for yield in property investments rather than capital gain. Now, this tendency back to a yield preference will actually help reduce the risk profile and the cyclical nature of property. Because if an investor is buying because of the current yield, their decisions will be less distorted by the current market enthusiasms, either of optimism leading to a boom or pessimism holding the markets in some sort of doldrum. And so again, this understanding of property and its importance in the community is a unique opportunity for property economists, and one which will be more fully realized in a land tax world. Slide. So far we've been looking at a fairly rosy view. We've seen that the average household will be better off to the tune of about $30,000 a year, or in other words, about a third of their current income. Phenomenal increase in domestic standard of living and economic stimulation. We've seen a number of other benefits in terms of land tax's ability to be able to redirect investment focus in a more healthy way and a more sustainable way. However, lurking in the cracks here is a rather unpleasant issue, and that is the question of transition. It's very hard to tell somebody who has just signed up for a mortgage that was going to take them perhaps the rest of their working life to work off, that they should simply give the land value of their properties to the government and somehow they're going to be better off as a result. Very hard thing to sell. And that is really one of the scariest things about strengthening land tax. What are the transitional issues? Well, essentially, if the community uses its rent on its land values as its source of community funding, public funding if you like, It really means that the community is giving away property rights to its land, because land tax erodes land values. For every dollar of land tax you're paying, that's one less dollar of net land rent that a landowner earns himself, and that is going to capitalize into a loss of land value. If that transition was sudden, it would mean a sudden and perhaps unjust resumption of property rights across the community. And obviously there'd be a fairly significant community outcry if the government was simply to come back and resume or dissolve property rights. However, there are a number of strategies for introducing land tax that overcome this rather blunt and rather ugly transitional issue. One is to look at the question of money in the community. We don't have time to go into the question of money in great detail. However, I'll leave it to you to check where money comes from in the community. One of the things which is surprising is that all money that exists in Australia today comes into existence as the result of debt, either as a result of the government borrowing money or value from the private market in the form of government bonds, which it then uses to back the currency it produces, or as a result of the activity of the banking system itself. What this suggests is that the government could retire its debt-based money by issuing money backed not on the gold that it has in some vault somewhere, but on other assets it owns, in particular the land value it owns. And this means that the government could, notionally, come along to an individual, buy the individual's land, let's say $100,000 worth of land, and on the basis of that, issue $100,000 worth of money. This would not be inflationary, because the money that was created would come as a result of $100,000 of land value going out of the community. It would also enable the government to retire $100,000 of its debt money. In other words, $100,000 of government bonds. Again, that would help the inflation situation overall. In the long term, the advantages to the community are twofold. First of all, because that $100,000 has enabled the government to borrow less money, the government has to pay less interest on those government bonds because they simply don't exist anymore. And so the government benefits immediately by about 5% on the value of its money. In addition, because the government now owns that land, it will earn land rent. If we assume a yield of about 4%, it means that the government is now earning about $4,000 per year on its $100,000 worth of money. And so the idea of having a country's money itself backed on the country's public landownership could have a double economic advantage for the community. This is not a new idea. It was first publicised by the English economist John Law several centuries ago. It exists as one possible way of exercising a transition to a land tax situation, which would be totally painless because the landowners today would simply sell their land back to the government. It would be resumed in a sense. A second strategy was suggested by the English political economist and thinker John Stuart Mill about midway through the 19th century, that is to say midway through the 1800s. And Stuart argued this way. He said that if we ignore the basis or the history of where land values come from and simply recognise that people today own land today, but however, if we say that future improvements in land value are the result of the community. And we apply the logic that we saw a few slides back simply to future increases in land value. What John Stuart Mill recommended was that we maintain land values from today at their current real values. And we introduce a land tax which simply harvests the future capital gain. This means that property owners today never lose anything as a result of the gradual introduction of a land tax. To give you an idea of what that would mean, had John Stuart Mill's recommendations been introduced in 1990, that is, about a bit more than two decades ago, something like 70% of Australia's other taxes would be retired by now. And they'd be retired in such a way that we would have no costs in their respective departments. 70% of our income tax would be gone. 70% of our GST wouldn't have got started. And so on. And the other taxes also would be retired. And that obviously would be an advantage. I think most people would prefer to live in a situation where, let's say, 3/4 of the taxes had disappeared. Now, John Stuart Mill's recommendation is able to be brought in without taking any land rights away from anybody, and simply recognising that in the future capital gains on land are the result of the doings of the community and should be returned to them. We've already seen the justification for this theory in terms of the sources of capital gains. And we've also seen the cultural resistance to surrendering what seems to be this magic way to make money without working. However, I want to look at the performance of land markets compared to the rest of the economy in this period, say 1990 to 2007 now briefly. We're going to look at a situation where we're going to start with a notional land value in about 1990 of $100,000. Historically, from 1990 to 2007, property grew across Australia at an average annual rate of 7.6%. During that time, however, wages only grew at 3% per annum. Now, most property economists are aware that property is an inflation hedge. In other words, property tends to grow at a higher rate, a stronger rate, than the rest of the economy. And so these numbers should come as no surprise. The fact that over this fairly long period, about 27 years, property growth was a full 4.6% above other prices in the economy. Here we're talking about wage growth. If we were to look at inflation, we would see that inflation was actually lower over that period than wage growth. We would say, yes, we all know that. That's the way that land works. But look at the long-term implications for having a situation where land values are increasing at something like twice the rate of wages growth. If we assume a household in 1990 where the land rent component of their housing costs constituted 10% of their household budget, their household costs, we can now look at how that projects into the future. By the time you get up to 2007, on the graph here, you can see what is happening between household incomes, which are the red line, and land prices and land rent, which is depicted in the blue line. Overall, land rents are increasing faster than household incomes, which means that the amount of disposable income that their household has to non-rental expenses, these include tax and all the other expenses of life, must necessarily be falling. And so we see this green line, which begins to rise as a result of household income rising. But its rate of growth over the last 27 years up to 2007 was lower than household incomes. If we were to project that trend out into the future, what we can see is that the level of disposable income available to the household falls off as land rents increase. And using those two rates, land rents increasing at 7.6% per annum, while wages only grow at 3%, we can see that the level of disposable income projected out in the future starts to plateau out around the early 2020s. And then it starts to fall because the rate of growth of housing costs, of real estate costs, starts to gobble up a greater and greater percentage of the household income, to the point where, using these facts from history, from 1990 to 2007, by the time we get to about the year 2040, housing costs as land rents will be occupying more like 90% of household income. And disposable income, in other words, that income that's available for other things, will be down around a tenth of household incomes. Now, what can we conclude from this? Well, first of all, it's unlikely that the community in general will accept a situation where housing costs in terms of land rents become something like 80 or 90% of household incomes. Politically and socially, that would be devastating for the community. If it did happen, the community would suffer such a radical polarization of income and, to a certain extent, a freezing out of the economy, because tenants and owner-occupiers would find themselves having to pay so much to buy their house or to rent it that they can hardly afford to live. When faced with the historical development in land values, especially when we look at their creeping impact against household incomes, we can see that far from being a benefit to the community in general, capital gains in land are in fact a creeping enemy for the community. There have been a number of studies in recent times looking at the effects on the average household of economic developments over, let's say, the past four decades or so, especially this side of about 1970. And generally the conclusions are fairly evident, that all of the productivity benefits that have been available in Western developed countries have tended to have been taken out by increases in real estate costs, especially household housing costs. When Elizabeth Warren looked at what she calls the two income trap, what she found was that of those costs that increased in real terms between 1970 and the mid-2000s, housing costs and health insurance were the only two costs that were significant. And they were significant for two reasons. One is that they are inescapable. The second is that they are now constituting a major part of household expenses, whereas back around 1970, they were significantly less so. And that trend tends to be moving on into the future. Warren found that whereas a household was able to survive on a single income in 1970, it now requires a double income, and in fact a double income with a very small number of dependents, in order to survive at the same relative standard of living today. And this would suggest that the march forward in capital gains on land has actually been to the detriment of the absolute standard of living, the general quality of life of the average household. Because the amount of free time that the members of a household once had has now fallen significantly. And if the present trends continue into the future, it's likely that this trend towards households being consumed by their housing costs is likely to continue. But let's look at the historical realities with respect to land tax. We've mentioned briefly that land tax was the dominant form of public funding up to 1900. That is perhaps only a mild expression of the reality. Land tax as a percentage of public revenue has been falling for about the last half millennia, that is the last few centuries, since about 1500. And with them, the general situation of the average working person, and in fact, the overall significance, the profitability of business owners. To the extent that Fred Harrison, when he wrote his book, The Power in the Land, was able to quote an observer who said that if you were to gather the 100 richest men in England towards the end of the 19th century, that is towards the end of the 1800s, you could be excused for thinking that the Industrial Revolution had not happened. What Harrison was saying in that quote was that landowners and property investors remained the dominant wealth earners, the richest people in England, despite all of the advances made through the Industrial Revolution with the advances of mechanization and so on. And this is because land taxes were falling off as a source of public revenue. The politics of taxation was complicated by Karl Marx, the communist, or at least the major exponent of socialism. Curiously, Karl Marx advocated the transition to an income tax and away from a land tax. That's right. The greatest proponent of communism the world has ever seen was promoting the taxation form that now is the backbone of Western free economies. And somehow, for some reason, the West has adopted Marx's recommendation of relying heavily on income tax. And so land tax continues to fall in prominence from Karl Marx's time to the present. But it certainly hasn't helped the free economy. Even more curious, considering income tax was a Marxist invention, is that the tendency away from land tax has helped to create a number of fortunes over that intermediate period. Simultaneously, and we saw this with the problem of road building on the north coast of New South Wales, is that it has strained public resources. If we look around today, we find many instances of public infrastructure that was built, say, over the last century or so, but would probably not be able to be built today. If we look at the transport infrastructure in the major cities of Sydney and Melbourne, we see things like the Sydney Harbour Bridge, or the electric rail systems in both Melbourne and Sydney and most other capital cities. However, today we can't build railway systems. If we do, we have to have public-private partnerships to do it. What that is telling us is that the community is no longer able to build these things. And if one is to go to a major city, say Brisbane or Sydney or Melbourne, and look at the scale of the railway system, You can stand back and wonder, could we do that today? And yet, largely these systems were built when we had considerable less productivity in the community. We didn't have computers or mobile phones or fax machines, and yet we're able to provide a very high level of infrastructure. Whereas today, if we want to build a new railway or a new road, typically it'll be done as a tollway or as a PPP, a public-private partnership. Closer to the property area, we could look at the development industry. Development was once very cheap. However, now developers are really infrastructure builders. Not only do developers have to build roads and drainage systems and fund the infrastructure within their developments with upfront expenses, which are then passed on plus their profit margins to the eventual purchaser, but the developers also have to pay for infrastructure outside of their immediate area, their immediate developments, to the government by way of development contributions. And we can see that there's tremendous controversy over development contributions and their level of cost, supposedly, to the community. The central problem of land tax, which has plagued it now for about 500 years, is that as we move to a democratic mindset and we recognize that land tax is really a form of making the government the landowner and paying land rent to them, in a democracy, we have the power to vote in our landlord, and we have, over the last five centuries, been progressively voting in soft landlords, landlords that are going to put down the rent lower and lower in order to attract your votes and mine. We see this writ large in the Australian Capital Territory, where less than 100 years ago, the system was set up with the expectations that Canberra would be self-funding on the basis that its land rents would pay for things like Lake Burley Griffin and the public service offices and all the rest of it, Government House, what have you, and the monuments. However, today, the land rent that the ACT government collects on the land that it owns and leases to private individuals is less than what is collected in Sydney for local government rates. That really means that the notion of realistic rental levels or ground rent levels in Canberra is an absolute joke. While we can see this quite evidently in the ACT, we can also see it in other places as well. About 10 years ago, the New South Wales government reviewed its pastoral leaseholders. It reviewed its pastoral leases, and it found that on average, the New South Wales pastoral leases were collecting rent at about 4% of a reasonable market level. The New South Wales government realised that it was political suicide to try and take the rent up to a market level immediately, given that this very low level of rental had become the norm, and farmers and so on had developed strategies assuming it was going to continue indefinitely. And so the government took a rather curious strategy to solve it. And that was, it offered the land to the lessees, to the tenants, on the basis of a purchase price being 4% of the market price. so they could freely buy it if they wanted for 4% of its land value, and then they would have freehold. However, if they chose not to buy it, then the rent would be due to return to rental values in a relatively short period of time. Now, from a pastoral leaseholder, there's really no decision to be made, because if the rents did return to market values, it meant that the offer of being able to buy the land outright for about 4% of its market value would mean that the farmers would be able to buy the land for about 1 year's rent. Again, it's an example of a total political failure of the government as landlord, and that has implications for the future of land tax. Overall, there is a widespread misunderstanding of property mechanics, and as we have noticed, and especially as evident in the chart on this slide, that capital gain is not necessarily an advantage unless you're in a position where you own more property than you're able to utilize yourself. And that is, it's not landowners that benefit from capital gain in land. It is only landowners who own additional investment properties. Now, while about a little under two-thirds of Australians own their own home, a relatively small percentage of those owner-occupiers also own investment properties. And while there's been quite a scurry towards buying investment properties over the last 10 years or so, and many of the new property investors have had their fingers burnt, overall, it is the long-term property investors that benefit from capital gain. For anyone who owns only the properties that they use for their residence and maybe their business, if their property increases in value, it doesn't necessarily make them wealthy. After all, if my property, my house, goes from being worth, let's say, $100,000 to $1 million, I might be able to borrow more money against that or something. But my standard of living does not change. I'm still living in the same house. And assuming my house has changed in value in the same way that the houses in the rest of my street or the rest of my town have changed, then the fact that my house is now worth $1 million doesn't help me, because I need to live in a house. And if I was to sell my $1 million house, I would then have to go and buy or rent another house, maybe in the same street or the same town, and so I'd then have to find that $1 million. I don't get to spend $1 million, is the real point here. And the same goes for commercial and industrial property as well. And so we need to rethink what land value does to the economy. There is a second misunderstanding that is important, and that is the false belief that land taxes get passed to tenants. While they may get passed to tenants in the very short term, in the longer term, this cannot be so. This is because the land market already charges tenants at the highest level that the market is able to bear. In other words, the highest level that the tenants are able to bear. And this would suggest that in the longer term, even though we might have an apparent transfer, in the longer term, that tendency will be for the land tax to have the impact of a slower trajectory of property value increases into the future. In other words, it eventually will be eroded out of the landowner's pocket in terms of rent over longer term, and leave the tenant, assuming a relatively efficient market, in about the same position as he started. And that's because of the assumption of the way that the mechanics of subsistence works across the community. given the political realities and the long-term historical trends, it's unlikely that land tax is likely to change in terms of its political attractiveness into the future. However, it's important that at least property economists are aware of the actual mechanics and rather the misunderstandings that what you find across the community in general.